Hey guys, Janus here. In today's video, we're going to be dealing with stretch-based exercise applications. In previous videos, I've talked about how our vascular system responds heartily to both shear stress and cyclic strain, hence the various spread of exercises on my channel. In past cases, however, I focused more heavily on smooth muscle-based stretch responses and less on endothelial-based response. Currently, I've been hunting down books that deal specifically with mapping endothelial cytoskeletons and the inner workings of the cell. While the literature is quite clear that endothelial cells do possess contractile units, I have yet to find solid pictorial references that show how they're arranged or literature dealing specifically with endothelial cell studies involving more extreme forms of cyclic strain, similar to what we might be exerting upon our capillary beds and various vascular structures, say during resistance-based exercise. Saying that, we can infer a few things indirectly given that resistance exercise, specifically the eccentric aspects inherent to such endeavors, can and will cause endothelial cell sprouting, migration, and proliferation. Furthermore, lab-based studies on cyclic stretch of endothelial cells shows that they do in fact orient themselves in three dimensions according to the direction of strain. It has also been shown to cause an increase in intracellular activity indicative of the beginning stages of cellular division, along with marked increases in growth factors like VEGF, which are known to directly exert effects on endothelial cell growth rates and metabolism. Even more promising is that labs are already implementing various ratios of shear stress and cyclic strain to bioengineer vascular components. On the whole, there's a sizable amount of evidence supporting a cyclic versus static-based stretch approach to vascular growth coming from the scientific community. When we couple this with our understanding of how motion is a part of our everyday lives, it practically becomes a no-brainer that vascular tissue, just like our well-studied skeletal muscle system, would respond beautifully to repetitive stretch. However, something which is not entirely clear is whether or not vascular tissue, specifically endothelial cells, are able to be exercised directly in a resistance-based approach. I say this because while we have numerous resources that indirectly point this being the case, my own experience provides evidence for this as well. I have not come across research that outright states that endothelial cells would be more apt to grow in the face of varying degrees of stretch. There are studies that have been done that do show that pathways known to influence or otherwise lead to cellular division are activated more strongly in the face of greater levels of distension, one such example being near maximal levels of stretch causing a 7-fold increase in VEGF levels, as well as a dramatic increase in nitric oxide release. Practically applying this information, we can see such effects firsthand with cyclic stretch-based exercise approaches applied to the male sexual organs. Specifically, how with even as few as 10 to 15 reps of the fulcrum exercise, for instance, we can directly cause a dramatic increase in engorgement levels up to and including an erection. More intriguingly, we can also witness what may very well be a telltale sign of growth in the days following a cyclic stretch-based exercise endeavor. One of the most notable being more full morning erections and others being a much more heavy hang throughout the day following such an exercise plan. Personally, when not performing any other type of exercise, I usually notice morning woods and fullness will wane on about the third day after exercise. If we compare this with anecdotal claims from around the internet, some of the largest gainers around have opted for some of the most conservative exercise approaches in terms of frequency, which would line up nicely with my own observations concerning stretch-based exercise applications. Going a step further, and accounting for all the factors I've mentioned thus far, an interesting story plays out whenever I purposely tweaked my caloric and protein intakes. While in both cases, erectile fullness and frequency lessens, I notice this much more prominently when protein levels drop. While I have yet to come across a paper that talks directly about the effects of protein and calorie restriction outside of papers and books on cancer growth rates, I believe my observations thus far paint a much more vivid picture, which I will continue to talk about throughout the Builder series. Well guys, that's it for this week's video. If you're new to my channel and you enjoyed this video, go ahead and press that subscribe button now to keep on top of my releases. I'll see everyone next Sunday, and as always, I'm your host, Janus, signing off.